Hello, this is Gallifreyan Jedi speaking, and I would like to welcome you to my YouTube channel. For the video blog for the month of June of 2015, I will be doing, as promised, on Star Wars Mythology, number 2, on the topic of Does Earth Exist in the Star Wars Universe? And I pose this topic with a question mark, and the reason why I do this is because there's a lot of ambiguity on this topic. There's a lot of ambiguity and controversy, not extreme controversy, but kind of controversy that is more ambiguous, shall we say, because there are many fans, Star Wars fans. I mean, first of all, let me back up a little bit. George Lucas himself had never confirmed one way or the other. So he's, you know, we're making an argument from silence either way, because he's never confirmed one way or the other. And to me, George is the only one who can truly say what is canonical and not for the Star Wars universe, even in spite of the fact that he sold Lucasfilm to Disney. But as far as, apart from George, the opinions have come out, there have been many fans, and even many of the EU authors whom I've met and talked with at the celebration conventions, the very celebration conventions that I, Star Wars celebration conventions that I've went to, have felt that Earth does not exist in the Star Wars universe. They felt that the Star Wars universe is something, is a mythological or a fictional universe, which has total discontinuity, has no connection, no continuity connection between our universe, our known universe, and the fictional universe of Star Wars. So it's total discontinuity, unlike what most other science fiction franchises like Star Trek, Doctor Who, Stargate SG-1, and many others. I can go on and on, list of science fiction movies and television shows and franchises where they have a fictional universe, but our Earth also exists. You know, reality collides with fiction. But like I said, there have been many fans, and even a lot of the EU authors, not all of them, but many of the EU expanded universe authors, excuse me, for those of you who don't know what EU stands for the expanded universe authors, who feel that Earth does not exist. It's something that's totally disconnect and discontinuity with our universe. I feel that it's not as simple as that. It's not simply as black and white as that. There's another opinion which I'm going to express and explore. I'm going to explore this topic, and I'm going to explore some of the theories, a couple of the theories or so, and give my own opinion on it. Because I don't think, like I said, I don't think that the issue of that the Earth doesn't exist, it's a totally mythological concept, totally disconnected and discontinuity with our universe, as many in the fandom of Star Wars do believe. I don't think it's as black and white, like I have said. So I'm going to explore an alternate possibility, and also explore some of the apocryphal or non-canonical material which has referenced Earth in the Star Wars universe. And one thing that I think that I can push for canonical, which I'll get to the end, I don't want to give any spoilers out right now. You'll have to watch the whole entire video to get to that point. But let me just say this, even on the canonical point, which I'm going to try to make an argument as canonical, you have to take this with a grain of salt. And the reason being is, unfortunately, this topic will be forever an issue of ambiguity. And the reason being is, like I said, I believe that only George Lucas has the right to comment on what is canon and official continuity and canon for Star Wars, the Star Wars universe, even after he sold. I mean, many people believe, and I've made these arguments before in previous videos, especially the last video I did on my assessment of Celebration and my assessment and points of view on Celebration and Anaheim, that even there are many that feel that George now, because after he sold Lucasfilm to Disney, that he's irrelevant. His opinion is nullified and he's irrelevant now. I don't feel that way. Matter of fact, I'm still very sore about how the Lucasfilm team, you know, Leland Chi, Pablo Hidalgo, and many others, how they are treating the legacy of Star Wars and their respect for George Lucas, or dishonesty, disrespect. And I really, at this point, I do not listen, even though that Disney legally has, what's the term I'm thinking of? Disney has intellectual property rights to Star Wars. My personal opinion as a fan, as a lifelong fan, is I don't consider that Lucasfilm team as authoritative on Star Wars mythology. I consider what has been established in the 6 movies, the Clone Wars, and also the classic EU, which Disney now has branded as Legends, as that has defined what is canonical for the Star Wars universe, what is authoritatively canonical for the Star Wars universe. So I'm going to be relying on those 3 things, the 6 films, the Clone Wars series, and also the classic expanded universe, branded as Legends. To me, that is what I consider authoritative, shall we say, quote-unquote, quote Bible, unquote, of Star Wars mythology and universe. So that's what I'm going to be relying on. But see, keep in mind, like I said, George is not in the picture. He never commented when he still had Lucasfilm, one way or the other. So it was very ambiguous back then, and it's even now ambiguous now. And no matter what Chi or Hidalgo or any of the Lucasfilm team under Disney want to make claims to, I ignore them. So if they make a claim, an official claim today, that Earth does not exist, to me, that doesn't matter. That doesn't count worth salt. I don't, you know, I hold no authority. I don't trust their authority. I don't respect their authority. So I don't hold anything they say as canonical of what I believe about the Star Wars universe. I know that gets touchy and controversy the way I'm approaching this, but that's just my personal feeling. I really don't care what Hidalgo or Chi or any of the others on the Lucasfilm Disney team have to say about Star Wars canonicity and continuity for the universe and mythology of Star Wars franchise. So, but like I said, I'm going to be dealing with those other 3 tiers that I've just mentioned as the authoritative sources, which I'm going to use to deal with the topic of, does Earth exist in the Star Wars in the Star Wars universe? And in order to do so, okay, let me back up, because I'm getting a little ahead of myself. I want to say that, like I said, I'm going to be giving some opinions out, sharing some theories and giving my opinions, strengths and weaknesses, and giving my own personal opinion. But I'm going to say now, and I will reiterate this later in the video, that you have to take what I say with a grain of salt because of the ambiguity. I'm only giving my opinions when I share my opinions of what I think is true about this topic. I'm sharing an opinion. I'm not saying that this is absolute fact. If you don't agree with me, then you're not a Star Wars fan. I'm not saying that at all. Like I said, I'm telling you to take what I say with a grain of salt, because I could be wrong. I'm just sharing an opinion. So I encourage you to say this. We'll reiterate this again when I get to certain topics on this issue, just to show that I'm not trying to be overbearing in my opinion. I'm just sharing my opinion, what I think it is. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to jump in, and the first thing I need to do, now you might think I'm going off topic, but actually this is key on topic. I've separated this into 3 things. First is the origins of the human race in the Star Wars galaxy. The second is the apocryphal material, Star Wars material, you know, the non-canonical apocryphal material. You know, apocrypha means books and material that is not canon or authoritative to the overall mythology. So that I'm going to be dealing with that. And then the final thing is the, which I'm not going to mention what it is, but what I think is can be pushed as canon for answering this question, does Earth exist in the Star Wars universe? But you might question, well, why am I dealing with the origins of the human race? Isn't that off topic? No, it's not. It's very much on topic. And I'm using the topic today of does Earth exist in the Star Wars universe. I remember having taken a couple classes with a professor in college. And this professor was famous for teaching classes on a particular topic, but using that to broaden the topics, because it was a way he could teach certain things. He could teach certain things without, that he probably maybe never would get around to teaching as a separate course. So he introduces it. And for instance, I took a course, you know, the most famous class in the summertime about the most famous murderers in history. Well, what he did is when he took, you know, when, say, for instance, Jack the Ripper, he went in to talk about the culture of Victorian London. And that's because that gives you the backdrop of what Jack the Ripper was. And that's how he introduced the concepts and teaching on the culture of Victorian London. That's how he introduced it, because it wouldn't be a separate topic, a separate course he would teach it. He brought these elements in to explain the background, to give you a foundation of Jack the Ripper. Well, that's what I'm doing today, is because, you know, I wanted to deal with the origins of the human race in the Star Wars galaxy, because I think that's very important for, you know, especially a Star Wars mythology blog. But being that the planet Earth, we're trying to get at the question, does Earth exist in the Star Wars universe? Well, Earth, the predominant sentient species on the Earth, is humanity, the human race. So I thought that this would be a perfect time to introduce the concepts of what is the origins of the humanity or the human race in the Star Wars galaxy. Because I think getting at that question will give us a foundation so we can answer the question, does Earth exist in the Star Wars universe? But without further ado, let's jump in. I want to, not to get off topic again, I want to mention about Star Galactica, because whatever the case might be, assuming with the possibility that Earth does exist, it's going to be very similar to the Battlestar Galactica mythology. And it's not exactly the same. You're not retelling the same story. It's a very different story, but there is parallel overlaps with, and one of the things would be is if Earth does exist, and the human race will have originated in the Star Wars galaxy or on another planet other than Earth, just the same as in Battlestar Galactica. Well, the story, and I'll just give you a quick overview of Battlestar Galactica. With the story of the human race and the origins of the human race in Battlestar Galactica universe, the human race was created and evolved on the planet Kobol. And that's where they lived, that's where the human race lived and thrived for thousands of years until the planet was dying. Then humanity decided, because the planet was dying, in order for survival of the human race, they set out to space to look for other planets to colonize. And overall, there was 13 tribes that set out to the stars. 12 tribes went one way. The 13th one went an opposite way, went a different direction. But the 12 tribes found a star system of 12 planets. Some of them were habitable, or the other ones they terraformed in order to colonize. So there was 12 planets that they colonized. That became the 12 colonies of man. And of course, the 13th tribe, according to the legend, in Battlestar Galactica, that went to, they went to Earth. They became the humans on Earth, the 13th tribe, where the 12 tribes became the 12 colonies of man. Well, as you know, make a long, long story short, in the thousand-year, or what they call a yarn is a year for them, year of war with the Cylons, at the end, Cylons were able to destroy the 12 colonies. And so the survivors, the few survivors of the colonies, set out in a ragtag fleet following the last Battlestar Galactica that had survived, and they went searching for Earth. Well, that is essentially the foundation story of Battlestar Galactica. Now, like I said, Star Wars is telling a completely different story, but just same way, but my point is that if Earth exists in the Star Wars universe, then what we have is the human race will have originated on a planet in the Star Wars galaxy the same way that the human race in Battlestar Galactica originated on the planet Kobol. But let's talk about the origins of the human race now. Let's jump into more details of the human race and the Star Wars galaxy. Okay, in the Star Wars galaxy, and keep in mind, some of the information I'm getting is from Wikipedia, and that's where a lot of my research has come from, in addition to all the EU novels and Star Wars, you know, everything, all the other Star Wars material that I've gleaned over the years. But let me jump in. I apologize for getting a little ahead of myself. In the Star Wars galaxy, humans are taxonomically referred to as Homo sapiens. They were the galaxy's most numerous and politically dominant sentient species, with millions of major and minor colonies galaxy-wide. Believed to have originated on the galactic capital of Coruscant, they could be found anywhere, engaged in many different pursuits. Spacers, mercenaries, smugglers, merchants, soldiers, assassins, farmers, crime lords, laborers, slaves, slavers, and many others, including Jedi and Sith. Since humans were the most common sentient species, they were often considered to be a standard or average to which the biology, psychology, and culture of other species were compared. Okay, so that's what we get. That's a foundational paragraph from Wikipedia that we get of what humans are. What humans are in the Star Wars galaxy. But let me go on and give you my research, conclusions to my research about humanity in Star Wars galaxy. It says, humans in the Star Wars galaxy are equally the same type of Homo sapiens. Keep in mind, Homo sapiens is a term that we use, is homogeneous, you know, for mankind. That's Homo sapiens is a term that we use for modern man. So let me repeat that. Humans in the Star Wars galaxy are equally the same type of Homo sapiens that are in our real world, with the exception of the midichlorians, which inhabit the cells, which inhabit the cells of not only humans in the Star Wars galaxy, but all living things. So that's what separates humans in the fictional world of Star Wars compared to humans in our real world on Earth, is that humans, as well as all living beings, you know, all living creatures, not just humans, but all the alien species and stuff like that, anything that's living has midichlorians in Star Wars mythology, in the Star Wars universe, in the Star Wars mythology, all living beings, sentient, non-sentient, have midichlorians, including humans. Now, keep in mind, if Earth does exist, and the humans, which I will cover this a little bit later, humans, too, also have midichlorians, because they exist in the Star Wars mythology. They would be, even though it would be exact representation of our real world, it would still be a fictional Earth, and in that fictional Earth, they would have, the humans would have midichlorians, as well as the animals, you know, our dogs and our cats and everything, would have midichlorians, which wouldn't be the case with us in our real world. That's the distinction between reality and the fictional world. But keep in mind, midichlorians are not just only in humans, they're in all living things, whether it be humans, aliens, sentient or non-sentient beings, animals, or whatever. Human being is a subcategory of humanoid species. Keep in mind, if you watch a lot of science fiction programs, you hear the term humanoid. Okay, how's this defined? Okay, humanoid species, which is categorized as bipedal sentient life forms. Bipedal, shall we say. Bipedal means walking upright on two legs. That's what bipedal means. Sentient means intelligent, complex and intelligent. Life forms that have characteristics similar to humans. Humanoid species is the most common sentient life form in the galaxy. So, when they say humanoid species, that means a living being, a sentient living being, that has a lot of similarity. Like I said, bipedal means they walk upright on two legs. They have two limbs, two arms, two legs. You know, that kind of stuff. Very similar. That's the most common species, sentient species in the Star Wars galaxy. Now, others would be that are not that way, that are not humanoid, would be an example like Hutts. That would be an example because they look like big slugs. That's why they're not. Hutts are definitely not humanoid. But anyway, that's what a humanoid is. And a humanoid would be characterized as human, near human, which I'm going to get into these definitions in a minute. Human, near human, and non-human, alien. So those three categories, you would find humanoid species under that genre or that categorization. Okay, let me go on. The term baseline human is used by anthropologists in the Star Wars galaxy to designate the unique distinctiveness of the human race as opposed to near human species. Now keep in mind, I just mentioned non-human, like we have Rodians, we have Twi'leks, and many other non-human alien races. But we're going to deal with the distinction between human and near human. The human, which is basically, as I described, which would be the exact human being, kind of human being that you would find here on planet Earth, that's referred to as baseline human. And so when anthropologists in the Star Wars galaxy refer to baseline human, they're referring to a human being that is exactly similar to you and I, exactly the same as you and I. Now, and what is the near human species? Well, let me go on to, because that's distinct from the baseline human. Okay, near human species. Let me describe what's going on here with humanity. Okay, the human genome, keep in mind, genome means genes from DNA. You know, you might be referred to it in the real world, the Human Genome Project. But let me go for this in the fictional universe of Star Wars. Okay, The human genome was considered to be remarkably adaptive. In reaction to environmental changes, selection pressures only needed a few millennia to engage new genes and reshape human bodies. A consequence of that exceptional adaptability was the existence of many near-human species. There's an offshoot of baseline humans who had followed their own evolution. Such examples of near-human species are Chiss and Hapens, Pawns, and Zygarians. Okay, Chiss and Hapens are very familiar, and I chose to mention those, is because they are a very prominent race. Both of them are a very prominent race in the classic EU, Expanded Universe. The Chiss were involved with especially Timothy Zahn's Thrawn trilogy and the Hand of Thrawn. Grand Admiral Thrawn, and he was a Chiss. and basically they were the same Chiss, or pretty much majority of their body structure is the same as far as having a head, two arms, two legs, you know, two limbs, bipedal. But they had red, their pupils were red, crimson red, and their skin was blue. Well, you don't have any human beings that are that way. They look distinct. So they look very similar to humans, but also very distinct. And, of course, the Hapens are very similar. Hapens were the ones, if you remember, from the courtship of Princess Leia. They were interested in getting Princess Leia. And later on, in the New Jedi Order, with Jaina Solo, they're trying to get her to marry into the royal families of the Hapens. Well, the Hapens were also a very near human species. Some of them were so close that they almost considered them a subcategory of baseline human. But still, they're classified by anthropologists as near human species. Chiss, example, Hapens are another. Those two are from the expanded universe. Now, the other two that I mentioned are from the movies and from the Clone Wars. The Pawns are from Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith. You remember when Obi-Wan went to Utapau, you had the Pawns. They looked very tall. I mean, they look a little bit more alien than the Hapens and the Chiss do, granted. But they're still categorized by anthropologists as near-human species. And they appeared in Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith. And the Zygerians appeared in several episodes of the Clone Wars. Specifically in Season 4, they had the story arc of the Slaves of the Republic. But Zygerians, they look a little bit more alien than the Chiss and the Hapens. But still, they're still classified by anthropologists as near-human species. So essentially, a near-human species are species that are related to humans in such a way, the baseline humans in such a way, that they can actually breed with them. And some of them do have crossbreeding. They marry, intermarry, and they breed. Obviously, we know when they were trying to get Princess Leia and Jaina Solo, who are baseline human, they were trying to get them to marry the Hapens. There was a near human species. So basically, near human species are related to baseline humans in the Star Wars galaxy. And I guess if you go back far enough, they have a common ancestor. But they split off and had their own evolution. You know, baseline humans were the ones who became dominant in the galaxy, and then you have near humans, which had their own evolutionary history. And they became distinct, but similar. They're similar in the sense that they're related. It's very much similar. Think about this. You have a category like canine species. And in that you have dogs, and you have wolves, and you have foxes. And each of those are distinct. You know, dogs and wolves and foxes. You can interbreed them, believe it or not. You can take a wolf and a dog, which they know. And actually, dogs evolved from wolves. This is what we know as scientists. Dogs evolved from wolves. So we know that you have these canine species, but each species, whether it be wolf, a dog, or a fox, each had their own distinct evolutionary history. Well, the same thing with humans, or the human race, that each of them baseline, all of them are humanoid, and all of them are humanoid. They have that common ancestry, but they had their own distinct evolutionary history, just like baseline humans did, and then also the other near human species. They're all related, just like wolves and dogs and foxes are related to each other as canines, whether human or humanoid. They're all these races, whether it be Chiss, Zygerians, Hapens, Pawns, they're all related to baseline humans. But they have their own distinct evolutionary history, chain in history. Well, anyway, also too, this is not unlike, I want to touch on real Earth science. Not unlike real Earth science, where paleontologists talk about the relationship between the relationship between the nature and evolution of Homo sapiens, Neanderthal species. If you know evolutionary history, there's many bipedal hominids other than Homo sapiens from our past, gone thousands and thousands, hundreds of thousands of years in our past. Neanderthal being one big example, Cro-Magnon man. They're probably very much more primitive. I mean, they ultimately became extinct. And even some scientists think that, like Neanderthal, that maybe we interbreed it, possibly, theorized, speculated, not known for sure. But there was some tests and wondering, speculation on whether maybe hundreds of thousands of years in our past that there was Homo sapiens who interbred with Neanderthal and stuff like that, but we don't know for sure. But we know that these hominids might have had a lot, very similar to the baseline human and these near-human species that we see in the Star Wars galaxy, very similar that we have to Homo sapiens and Neanderthal and Cro-Magnon and all these other hominid species we have in our past. So that's not these the baseline human and the near-human species in the Star Wars galaxy is not, it's very fantastic when you think about in science fiction, but it does have its similarities in truth in real Earth science and Earth's history in the past, far in the past, because now, today, in the 21st century, and obviously for the last 10,000 years, Homo sapiens have been the predominant life form, sentient life form, on the planet Earth. But anyway, let's move on, because I think there's some more important information that we need to move on with that. Alright. In the Star Wars galaxy, let's go on to some of these little interesting facts. In the Star Wars galaxy, the average human lifespan was 100 to 120 years. And interesting enough, 120 years is probably the max that they can live. And ironically, theoretically, that's the longest in today's world that a human being, we don't think we have any recorded, we have people, we have a rarity, but we do have recorded people who do live over 100, maybe 110, 100, maybe even some rare cases, 115. So 120 is not unheard of, it's not something, but that's probably the limit to which modern man can live to. We don't have people living to 300, except in the biblical time. In the biblical time, we had people living hundreds of years, but that was during the time of Noah. After Noah's time, it says in Genesis that God limits human lifespan to 120 years, so I do find that interesting. But when they talk about average 100 years to 120 years, that's probably because on average today in America, in the early 21st century today, the average lifespan is anywhere from 70 to 90 years. You know, if you look at the death rate of people, like when people are dying, it's anywhere from around 70 to around 90. And of course, you do have those rarities of people living over to 100. So probably the 70-year range would be like the 100. Someone living in Star Wars galaxy would be like living to 100 years. And someone living 90 to 100 years on Earth would be like equivalent to somebody living to 120 years in the Star Wars galaxy. Now, interesting enough, those humans who are force sensitive, force users, and were able to use the force, not just force sensitive, but they were force users, Jedi, Sith, and you know, and others who learned how to use the force, they were able to known to extend their life to 200 years. And that's probably because of the midichlorians and the use of the force. They were able to use the force to extend. I mean, the force can't make you live forever, can't give you immortality, but it can extend your life. And there have been humans in the Star Wars galaxy who have been force users who have extended their life to 200 years. But that's a rarity case. It's probably the rarity of that is probably the same that we have here on Earth when we see somebody live to 110 years old, or 115. So, I just find that interesting. Okay, let me moving on. Having a recorded and civilized history reaching back far beyond the beginning of space travel, the origin and early history of humans was lost to their scientists in the depths of millennia. Whatever the original homeworld was, it was universally accepted that humans evolved on one of the core worlds, near the galaxy center. Keep in mind, core worlds, if you go back, if you're confused by the different sections of the galaxy, the core worlds were the first to be civilized, the first to develop space travel and advanced technology, the first to develop intergalactic civilization, and stuff like that. Look at my video on Star Wars Mythology 1 on the galaxy. I explain that more in detail. But it's essentially that human beings were created and evolved somewhere in the core world, somewhere on a planet in the core worlds. That's where they began. Close to the galaxy center. Humans were among the few sentient species in the galaxy's home world is unknown. And like I said, that there's ambiguity. Not only ambiguity in the sense of creators like George Lucas never officially naming or claiming the planet of origins for humanity, but they even added into the mythology that some of the records go back so far that they're lost. Some of them are lost, and anthropologists and archaeologists in the Star Wars galaxy have a little bit of theorizing and ambiguity when it comes to the homeworld of humanity. So they don't even know. They speculate just like we're speculating, but nobody knows 100% for sure. We have to take the best evidence we have and come to the best educated conclusion, conclusion that we have, our best educated opinions, shall I say. But let's go on with some of these facts. Now, here's an interesting one, and this is one that I favor. I'm going into a direction where I feel I'm making an educated opinion based on all the information available. To move on to that, it says, according to an inscription found by archaeologist Dr. Ulup Zathan, if I'm pronouncing his name right, Dr. Ulup Zathan and Femme Noir on Sol 5 around 4 ABY. Remember, ABY stands for after the Battle of Yavin, so that's 4 years after the Battle of Yavin. Humans originated, this is the inscription when they translated, humans originated on the planet Neutron. And Neutron is an archaic name for Coruscant, the planet Coruscant, which is the central planet, or the capital planet of the galaxy. From most anybody who's seen all six movies knows that. The Coruscant is a center. In a Coruscant for the galaxy, the Star Wars galaxy, is what Earth is for the Federation in Star Trek. But it was always known as Coruscant. Its name used to be called Neutron in the ancient past. The ancient Zell nations who drove the near-human Tong from Coruscant may have been the progenitors of later humans. Well, let me go in. Because the planet, in its ancient history, we're talking about prior to space travel, well, maybe at the beginning of space travel, which I'll get to in a second, but in its ancient past, primitive past, there was two races. You had the Zell and you had the Tong. So let me describe what the Tongs are first. The Tongs were an ancient species of humanoid simians, indigenous to the galactic core world of Coruscant. They were 2 meters tall, gray-skinned, and were warriors from youth and viewed battle as a source of honor for both individuals and their gods. So the Tongs we know are near-human species, very similar to what I've described, that the Chiss and the Hapens and the Pawns are very similar to that. Famous for the struggle against the human battalions of Zell, prehistoric Coruscant, other major power, keep in mind the two powers of two races were the Tongs and the Zell. The Tongs waged war against their enemies, meaning the Tongs and the Zells were at war, constant war, for centuries with each other, for hundreds of years. When a powerful, now listen to this, this is interesting. One of the major events that happened in the ancient past is a powerful volcano erupted on Neutron, aka Coruscant, and it devastated the Zell by spewing ash into the sky with such density it blocked out the light of Coruscant's sun. And basically what you have here is the what scientists would refer to in our world, in our real world, as like the nuclear winter, which a very powerful, like a super volcano, like what you have in Yellowstone Park, could do, a full-on engaged nuclear war between two superpowers of the world would cause the same. It was believed to have happened, that was destruction of the dinosaurs when a huge meteorite 65 million years ago at the end of the Cretaceous period hit into the Earth and was the catastrophic event that wiped out the dinosaurs, officially wiped out the dinosaurs. But what these catastrophic events do, why they're so catastrophic, is it's because the explosion is so powerful that it blows all this debris and dust high up into the upper stratosphere. And it stays there, just doesn't come down. It stays there for quite a time, sometimes years, sometimes decades. But at least a few years it stays. It's very thick and it blocks out the sun. When you block out the sun, that's devastating consequences for all life on that planet. Because your plants die, no photosynthesis, plants die. And when the plants die, then your animal life dies. So, you know, animals that eat the plants, they can die. And then human beings, the highest life forms, those are highest on the chain, who can eat both vegetable material and also meat products, they don't have enough food. So it can be very devastating. Well, in the ancient past, Coruscant, or Neutron, what was known at the time, had that a very powerful volcanic explosion. And you had that nuclear winter over Coruscant for many years. And it blocked out Coruscant's sun and devastated the planet. And had devastating effects, probably reduced their population tremendously, down to, you know, very small numbers. The Tong labeled themselves at this time. Now keep in mind, they probably survived better. They had better survival rates than the Zell because of the warrior-like nature, I'm assuming. But the Tongs labeled themselves Warriors of the Shadow, or in their language, Da, Verda, Verda. And that's in their own language, what it means, Warriors of the Shadow. But despite their loss, the Zell eventually managed, after this, in spite of this, now keep in mind that both survived that devastation after years, and even the Zell survived, even though they had devastating losses. But despite their loss, the Zell eventually managed to drive the Tong from Coruscant. And the defeated Tong fled to the planet Rune, located in the Outer Rim. So I guess after this event, this major catastrophic event, they went back to war. The survivors of the Zell went back to war. And I guess they became very dominant and were able to defeat the Tongs. And were able to push them. Their ultimatum is they forced them to, because this is, I guess, at the beginning of space travel, the very beginning, forced the Tongs to leave the planet to find their own planet. So they did. They left. The Tongs left Coruscant, fleed, and it probably took them hundreds and hundreds of years because they were traveling at sublight speeds. And they left for the planet Rune, because that's located in the Outer Rim, and that's probably one of the farthest outreaching planets that they did. It probably took them hundreds and hundreds of years to reach that planet at the sublight speeds they were traveling. But once they got there, there they remained for millennia, until legendary Mandalore the First led the Tong to conquer a new world, which they named Mandalore, planet Mandalore, and honored their new leader. So Mandalore was a Tong. Mandalore the First was a Tong. He conquered another world, and they renamed that world, rechristened that world, called Mandalore, and it was in honor of their leader. And consequently, the Tongs subsequently recast themselves as Mandalorians. So the Tongs at that time, after the conquest of that planet, rename of that planet in honor of their new leader, Mandalore I, the whole race became known as the Mandalorians. That was the origin of the Mandalorians. Now, I'm not going to talk about the Mandalorians because that's going to be another save it for another Star Wars Mythology blog. But I'm going to get into that because we know that the Mandalorians, if you watch the Clone Wars, are humans. They're actually baseline humans. So we're going to discuss how that evolved into becoming into being. But I'm not going to go into that now. But the Tongs were the original Mandalorians. That's where their history was. That's where their ancient history was. They were the original Mandalorians. And they maintained for centuries and over the millennia their warrior-like caste, their warrior-like nature. Now the Zell, let's go back to the Zell. The Zell were a people indigenous to Coruscant. And again, planet Neutron at the time, they were indigenous just like the Tongs were indigenous. So the Zell were an indigenous people to the planet Neutron, aka Coruscant. And they were the possible ancestors of the humans inhabitants of the world. They consisted of 13 nations known as the Battalions of Zell. So these people, known as the Zell, were believed, very possible, strong possibilities, archaeological evidence, that they were the ancestors of baseline humans, or humanity, in the Star Wars galaxy. And if that's the case, then if Earth does exist, the humans on Earth in the Star Wars universe, in Star Wars mythology, the humans on Earth, if Earth does exist, their ancestors will have been from the Zell in that fictional universe. They consisted of 13 nations, like I just mentioned, 13 different nations that banded together. And that banding it together of those 13 nations were known as the Battalions of Zell. Now, let me mention, I would be amiss if I failed to mention some other theories. But that's my educated opinion on what is the preferred belief of the origin of humanity. The history of Coruscant, the ancient history of Coruscant, and the origin of humanity, and also the Mandalorians, too. But that's my educated opinion for that. But I would be wrong if I didn't mention another theory. It's also believed by some that an ancient far-faring civilization, such as the Celestials, transported early humans from the original home planet and seeded them on other planets. Keep in mind the Celestials. Let me get this, because I have this. Let me talk about the Celestials. So for those of you who don't know who they are, Celestials, also known as the Architects, were an ancient civilization who were present long before the dawn of the Galactic Community, meaning the Galactic Republic, and even the Rakatan Infinite Empire. Whatever was known of the Celestials was a subject of xenoarchaeology, because they're so ancient, because they go back not just thousands, but maybe millions of years ago. Millions. The topic of studying them is known as xenoarchaeology. It was theorized by both the Jedi and the Sith alike that the balance between light and dark sides of the Force was actually under the guidance of the Celestials. So maybe that'll be another topic for another Star Wars Mythology blog, to talk about the Celestials. But per se, is that we do know they existed in the ancient past, millions of years ago, and they were architects. It was even believed they were called architects because Corellia, the planet Corellia, the star system of Corellia, was artificially created. So that star system didn't evolve naturally, like all the other star systems did. It was created by the Celestials, artificially created, with them moving those planets into that star system. And it was believed that they had helped civilizations with technology and advancing their civilization, establishing it. And they even... Now this is where the belief comes in for the origin of humanity, that those who reject that Coruscant is the origin planet of the human race and the Zells were the ancestors of the baseline human, believed that humanity evolved on a different planet, some unknown planet that we have no knowledge of, no knowledge, no history, nothing. It's just a mystery, you know. It's Q, planet Q, who knows? Some planet out there that we don't know of, humanity evolved on. Celestials, it was believed that these celestials took humanity, took pockets of humanity from this unknown planet, from their planet of origin, and seeded them. And I guess it can even fit for those who believe, you know, the originating, them creating Corellia. We know that Corellia has a human population on it. So maybe it would fit with archaeologists, the Xenon archaeologists who theorized that maybe as the Celestials artificially created the Corellian system, that they seeded Corellia, the planet Corellia, with humans. Which is interesting. I wouldn't reject that notion. It's very possible that it happened. But I'm still holding on to the fact that the origin of humanity was on Coruscant and the Zell nations, where the Zell people were the progenitors, the originators, they were the ancestors of baseline humanity in the Star Wars galaxy. Interesting enough, that's very similar to the concept that you have in Star Trek. You know that anybody who's a Star Trek fan knows the concept of the Preservers, the race of the Preservers. And they were a race that came in, you know, again, thousands of years in the past in Star Trek mythology, Star Trek universe past. And they passed through the Milky Way galaxy, and they took different Earth civilizations that were dying out. Because there was an episode where they had Navajo Indians on the planet that were untouched by other races or modern technology. So it's believed that they took races that were dying out for various reasons and seeded them on other planets so they would, their culture would survive their extinction on Earth. And because they did this, because of their activities, that's the reason why the Milky Way galaxy in Star Trek, in the Star Trek universe, the Milky Way galaxy in the Star Trek and fictional universe. That's why there's so many humanoid, you know, of course, back in the day when they did the original classic Star Trek series, they didn't have the technology to come up with all these exotic aliens, so most of them were humanoid in some way. But they did come with a good explanation through their mythology that these preservers seeding these different planets with specific humans from various races, cultures that were dying out on Earth and seeding them on other planets is the reason why there's so many humans and humanoid races in the Milky Way galaxy. I just found that interesting. Well, the same goes with the Celestials. The only difference is, by those who hold to the theory, the difference is between the theory of Coruscant and the Zells being the originator of humanity and the Celestials is we agree that they were architects. We agree that they created the Corellian system, architected the Corellian system, and even probably seeded some of those planets. The only difference is the belief that still holding on to the fact that Coruscant was the home planet of humanity and the Zells were the ancestors of baseline humanity compared to humanity evolving on some unknown planet that we don't know of and seeding out into the galaxy through by the Celestials. That's the only difference, really, between those two theories. But anyway, I think it's important that we move on. Hopefully everybody is following me. But let's move on, and then we can talk about, you know, if you're confused by anything, sending me a comment for clarification. But anyway, let's move on. Prior to the Galactic Republic and the invention of the hyperdrive propulsion system, remember, the hyperdrive propulsion system is the piece of technology that gives spaceships the ability to travel in hyperspace, meaning very similar traveling into, which I'll get into the technology later in another blog, but it's like folding of space, like a wormhole, creating a wormhole that gives the ability to travel from one end of the galaxy to the other in a very short amount of period of time. But anyway, let me go back. Propulsion system. Early humans discovered space travel and used sleeper ships to travel from Coruscant, which had developed into a planet-wide city, to travel to and colonize other planets in the core system, such as Alderaan, Corellia, and dozens of others. Some of the others that I mentioned in my first Star Wars Mythology blog on the Star Wars Galaxy. Sleeper ships traveled at slower than hyperspace speeds, so it took ships decades or centuries to travel to different star systems, so humans would be kept in a state of suspended animation for the duration of the trip. So keep in mind, prior to the Republic, prior to hyperspace being discovered, and the hyperdrive propulsion system technology being invented, humans, and they discovered space travel, very much like we here on Earth in the 20th century have developed the technology and have taken our first steps to going into space and traveling to the moon, you know, landing on the moon. We haven't gone to Mars yet, which that would be an even better idea, but we've taken our first steps into space. Well, humans at this time, it's believed at this time that the baseline humans have evolved from the people of Zell, the nations of Zell. Coruscant, instead of being maybe a rural planet, turned into an urban planet. It was city-wide, so their technology had grown enough, obviously, we've seen. So they've taken the first steps into outer space, and when they ventured out further than Coruscant's star system, to travel to the other star systems in the core worlds, that's when the colonization of the other planets in the core worlds, like Alderaan and Corellia and others, assuming that Corellia wasn't seeded there by the Celestials, most of the populated worlds, originally populated worlds in the core system in the core, were humans venturing out from Coruscant. They were venturing out from Coruscant, traveling out in colonies, and they were seeding these planets themselves, colonizing these other planets in the core worlds, in the core, and they became human colonies, which eventually a galactic civilization. Now, they traveled in sleeper ships. The reason why they call sleeper ships is because it was these things that they slept in. See, their ships. Keep in mind, the hyperdrive propulsion system wasn't invented, and they haven't discovered hyperspace, traveling in hyperspace, so they traveled at sublight speeds. Now, probably their ships could go very close to the speed of light, but they couldn't travel at hyperspace. They couldn't travel through hyperspace at speeds like that to get from one end of the galaxy to other planets, to other star systems in a very short amount of time. Took decades and even centuries, so that could be lifelong journeys. You know, it could take generations to get to these other planets, and because of resources, you know, oxygen and food, and most likely that generation that left Coruscant for these other star systems, that they would be dead. Naturally be dead before they would reach these other star systems, because like I said, it would take too much on the resources that they need, especially food and water. They essentially put them to sleep. They kept them in suspended animation, known as the sleeper ships, and you see that in many other science fiction franchises. The alien movies, because the alien movies, they travel at slower than these sub-warp speeds or hyperspace speeds that they because trying to save resources on food and water and oxygen for their trip, they put themselves into suspended animation and it would the deep sleep, cryogenics. Well, that's what the sleeper ships were. They were cryogenics. They put the humans to sleep in a state of suspended animation. You have that in the Aliens. You also have that in the 2001, 2010, if you see that movie. So many science fiction stories that we know of have that concept of putting human beings to sleep for a long space journey. So that's what happened in Star Wars. In the early history, the pre-Republic era of history is that when they were traveling at these sublight speeds, these hyperspace speeds, that it took them decades and centuries, so as to save on resources like food and water and oxygen, and also that they wouldn't die of old age before they reached these other star systems, they put themselves into cryogenic suspended animation, so they would be alive when they reached these other planets. And then they colonized these other planets, which became human colonized planets in the core world. So keep in mind, most of the core worlds were originally colonized by baseline humans. They hadn't met any of the alien races as of yet. Keep that in mind. Now, approximately 25,200 BBY, that means 25,200 years before the Battle of Yavin, this is pre-Republic time, humans discovered hyperdrive technology. This is where the invention of the hyperdrive propulsion system was invented. And they developed the hyperdrive technology and used that to develop hyperspace cannons linking Coruscant with other populated planets, as well as the planet Doro. So basically, these colonies, which for hundreds of years, they were colonizing Alderaan and Corellia and all these other planets in the core system, in the core worlds, humans were. They finally, when they developed the hyperdrive technology, were able to develop these roadways. Well, I guess that's the best way to explain it. Hyperdrive cannons are like roadways to linking Coruscant with most of the other human populated worlds, such as Alderaan and Corellia. And they also connected it with Doro. Now, Doro was probably one of the rare worlds in the core that had an advanced civilization of non-human, alien race. But they also open up diplomatic relations as well as all the other human populated worlds when they linked through the hyperspace cannons all these other planets. Humans on the planet Corellia were the first civilization to develop the hyperdrive starship. The hyperdrive propulsion systems, they were able to use that to build it onto starships on the planet Corellia. So they were famous for doing that. So now starships could travel into hyperspace and travel to these different star systems in a very short period of time through the hyperspace cannons, which were developed earlier, when hyperdrive technology was first discovered. Now, this happened approximately 2553 BBY. That means 25,053 years before the Battle of Yavin. So it's 25,200 when they first discovered the hyperdrive technology and built the hyperspace cannons. And it was 2553. So that was approximately 150 years after they discovered the hyperdrive, humans discovered the hyperdrive technology and built these hyperspace cannons between the planets, between all the human-populated planets, and even Doro. Linking Coruscant with the human population planets and Doro. About 150 years later, approximately, that's when the humans on Corellia, first developed spaceships with the hyperdrive propulsion system so they can travel between these planets easy enough in a short amount of period of time. And this is where they spread an advanced technology, civilization, to all human-populated core worlds. This was the first intergalactic, because keep in mind, even though humans were leaving Coruscant thousands of years in the past and were colonizing, they were cut off after they colonized, because it took them hundreds of years sometimes to reach these other planets. Then they colonized it, but they were cut off from Coruscant and all the other planets that were being populated by humans. But once the humans developed the hyperdrive technology, and Corellia was using the hyperdrive propulsion system to their ships, and they were able to travel through these hyperspace cannons very easily and very shortly and quickly to these other planets, that's when they were able to develop an intergalactic civilization. Commerce, a common interest in commerce, trade, government. This was the first formations of the galactic. Well, the Galactic Republic didn't exist, but this was the first formations of a galactic civilization. The first formation, the first evolution, step in the evolution of a galactic civilization. And they spread their advanced technology to all the human population, all the humans, and also assuming all the Doros too, on the planet Doro. But in the core worlds, all the human populated worlds, all the worlds then became advanced, equally advanced, through common trade and cooperation of government and so on, you know, etc. Common trade and commerce and all that, they became a very advanced technological civilization. Still very primitive, but still, that was the first advanced galactic civilization that had developed and evolved in the galaxy. Okay, moving on, about that time, human scouts and explorers traveled further out in the galaxy and encountered non-human alien races and species, which was known as the Expansion Era. Now keep in mind, like I said, going back again, reviewing, the human beings thousands of years left Coruscant, and it took decades or centuries to reach these other planets like Corellia and Alderaan. They were cut off, but they colonized them. Human beings colonized these different planets. Then they developed the hyperspace propulsion system, hyperspace technology. And then they connected through these roads, these hyperspace routes, linking Coruscant and other planets, like Alderaan and Corellia and Doro, together. And then the Corellians developed spaceships which can easily travel to these various systems. Once they had done that and developed this first advanced galactic civilization, that was the time exploration. Let's explore, because keep in mind, the core was the only place in the galaxy that was explored by space travel. Other than the Doros, the humans were the only ones traveling through space. Doros were probably one of the first alien races that they encountered. But they had really hadn't encountered, other than humans, they really hadn't encountered other alien races. But when they developed this advanced civilization, galactic civilization, that's when they started to explore further, because the core was the only place in the galaxy that was space travel was happening, and where there was colonization and exploration. Now, since they had developed this advanced technology and this advanced this galactic civilization, they decided to explore the go out further into the galaxy and explore it further. This was known as the Expansion Era. This was termed as the Expansion Era in the Star Wars history, you know, the Star Wars galactic history. The Expansion Era, that's what it's referred to. And that's when they first started to come across all the alien races, you know, the Twi'leks and the Rodians and the Bothans and the Mon Calamarians, etc. All the alien races that we know, and the Hutts, and you know, etc. That's when they first encountered those alien races. The humans encountered, learned that they're not the only race in the universe. That there's millions or thousands of others and sentient alien races in the universe, in the galaxy, shall I say. And they opened up commerce and trade and cooperation with those planets as well, and gave them their technology so they could develop advanced technology, which further increased their galactic civilization. Okay? Like I said, humans, as they developed this advanced civilization, they were exploring the galaxy. They were going out further, exploring, which they hadn't. They hadn't had the resources or the civilization to be able to do that, because they remained only in exploring the core worlds. And they went out further into the galaxy after they had developed this advanced technology and this advanced this galactic civilization, the rudimentary of galactic civilization. They went out further into what we term as the colonies. In the encounter, keep in mind, as they went further to explore the galaxy further out, that's when they encountered all these other alien races, which I just previously mentioned. And also, too, what happened was that they started to colonize an area which is now known as the colonies. This was, the core worlds were the first worlds where the humans traveled to, colonized, left Coruscant, traveled to, and colonized, and then developed the first galactic civilization, intergalactic civilization. Well, after that happened, when they went to the region known as the colonies, they started to colonize those planets. Those were known as the colonies. It was sort of like what you have with America after the American Revolution and the United States was established. You still had the West, and the West was being explored and colonized and ultimately brought into the United States, you know, as states. Well, the same thing with that. The first colonies, think of it going out west, you know, go west, young man. You had the pioneers, human pioneers of the galactic, of this galactic civilization going out further into the galaxy and to the first colony regions. Now, if you know, again, watch my video on Star Wars Mythology number 1 on the galaxy. You had the core worlds. The second section that you have is the colony regions. That was the first section outside of the core worlds that human beings started to make contact with other alien civilizations and also started to colonize planets and bring them in through cooperation of trade and commerce and government, bring them into their formation of that their galactic civilization. Now keep in mind, this galactic civilization was still yet to be known as the Galactic Republic. Galactic Republic did not exist at this time, but the very primitive, rudimentary galactic civilization existed, and they were colonizing these planets in the colony regions at the time. So keep that in mind. But before the Galactic Republic was established, but we're getting on the verge that the officially the Galactic Republic was established 25,000 BBY, 25,000 years before the Battle of Yavin, that humans, through their exploration, keep in mind they went further, just like what we did in the West. We went further and further as we colonized, as we explored and colonized. Well, they did that too. They went further and further. They went to the colony. They first traveled and explored the colonies and established the colonies in the colony region. Then they went to explore to the inner rim. And then they went to the expansion, what the expansion region was, and then the mid-rim. And ultimately, they made it right before the formation, the days of the Old Republic began. They made it to the outer rim. And that was the farthest region out that they had established colonies and brought them into their galactic civilization. During the last pre-Republic years, humans reached the Outer Rim and populated planets as far away as the Tyan Cluster. The Tyanese, now listen to this, this is interesting. Some of you are very familiar with the EU will know this. The Tyanese warlord Zim Despot, whose conquest reached from the Phronese sweeps to the Cyclata Cluster at the edge of Hutt Space. Okay, he was one of the most prominent humans in pre-Republic history, Zim the Despot. He was a conqueror, human conqueror, who by this time they were exploring the Outer Rim and colonizing, human beings were exploring the Outer Rim and colonizing planets as well as encountering the alien races that were there, including Hutts, Nyctos, Kletus, Twilights, you know, all the races that I've talked about in my previous blog on the Star Wars Galaxy and the Star Wars Mythology blog number 1 on the galaxy. All those races in the Outer Rim they were encountering and also colonizing planets. Well, Zim the Despot, who was a conqueror, was conquering a lot of these planets. He was a conqueror, and he conquered a lot of regions and brought them in to his empire, his little empire, and came and then after conquering the Phronese sweeps and the the Psi Clata cluster at the edge of Hutt space, he had a conflict with the Hutts, and he went to war against the Hutts. There was a skirmish with the Hutts, and then he went to war. So that was famous, you know, your EU history. There was a war in ancient pre-Republic history between Zem, the despot, and the Hutts. And, well, anyway. Now we're going on. I've pretty much covered everything I'm going to do about the origins. Hopefully, if you have any questions, and give me your comments, write comments to if you need clarification with the origins of the human race and the Star Wars galaxy. But that's as far as what I'm going to cover. I'm going to move on now to the apocryphal Star Wars Expanded Universe material. And the reason why is because after we get to this period, after Zim the Despot, we're getting into the period of the beginning of the Galactic Republic. And I'm going to save that. I don't want to go too much further because I've gone as far as I wanted to go. And I'm going to save the history of the Galactic Republic for another blog. Probably after my next Doctor Who mythology blog, I'll probably do one on, you know, Star Wars Mythology number 3 on the Galactic Republic. I don't want to promise that, but that's what I'm tentatively thinking about. So I'll go further into the history of the Galactic Republic, what the Galactic Republic was and how it formed, etc., etc. But that's as far as I'm going to cover, as far as the origins of the human race on Coruscant, its space exploration and pre-hyperspace, hyperdrive, hyperspace travel, pre-sublight speeds, the colonization of the core worlds, their exploration into the other regions of the galaxy, their encountering of the alien races, and their colonization of these other planets to develop their rudimentary beginnings of a galactic civilization, of an intergalactic civilization. So that's where I want to cover it. So let me move on now to get into, let's talk about Earth. Well, let's talk about the apocryphal Star Wars Expanded Universe material. I was originally going to talk about, now keep in mind, like I said, apocrypha means material that is not accepted as canon. It's non-canonical, but yet interesting enough to take a look at, amusing enough. I was originally going to start out with Star Tours. Now, Star Tours is obviously apocryphal, non-canonical, because it's essentially a ride at Disneyland. And I talked about that in my previous blog on my assessment, my experience and assessment with Star Wars Celebration Anaheim, because I visited Disneyland in Anaheim, California, when I was out there. And I went on the Star Tours ride twice. I loved it. But they have on the Wikipedia site, and it's sort of like a non-comical parody, in the sense of it's like a homage parody for Star Wars, is that they have the idea that Star Tours is human beings from Earth get on this ship, and they're taken to the Star Wars galaxy, and they travel to the different planets in the Star Wars galaxy. Well, obviously that's non-canonical. It's apocryphal, non-canonical, and like I said, it's a parody, but a parody as a homage, not a comical parody like what you have with Spaceballs. But the first real thing that I really want to talk about, as far as apocryphal material, is the abduction to Eartha. Okay, let me read what I have here. The first appearance of Earth under the name Eartha. Okay, Eartha was another name for, was the name that they used, some of the aliens used, or shall I say the Duros used, for Earth in the Star Wars galaxy. That was the original name that they used for Earth in this apocryphal literature, shall I say. And the resource for this was in a book called Monsters and Aliens from George Lucas. This book combined photos and concept art from the original trilogy and other Lucasfilm productions with a variety of short fictional pieces. And in one of them, the Galactic Gossip once reported that newlywed Duros couple, Etro and Droza Ethel, had been abducted by humans and taken to a planet they identified as Eartha, aka which is Earth. These humans spoke a language which the Duros couple required Ariel synchronizes to understand. Obviously, because they didn't speak... they probably understood basic, but like I said, galactic basic is supposed to be different than English. Our English. The Duras were taken to a party, quote-unquote party, an event where Earth humans wearing a variety of uniforms... Obviously, this is what we're talking about is a costume party. Gathered around liquid canisters, alcohol. How could you misinterpreting that? At the party, the Doros were examined by the locals, brought to a table, made to consume food which resembled stationary products from the Retha system, which is probably in the Star Wars galaxy. After offending the hostess by stamping the food, Itru Ethat developed color lesions from eating a potato, scaring the humans away, left on their own, and Ethat's retired to the freezer. Interesting enough, nice little parody story. But let me continue. The Ethats spent the remainder of their time on Eartha, bouncing on antennas, reading vegetables, and choking books and paintings, interesting activities, which put up much less resistance than those they were used to. After over four solar periods, obviously 4 years, meaning 4 years, of these bizarre experiences, the couple was unable to find their own way home or find suitable objects to scratch. Fortunately for them, a young human who dropped by to throw piles of folded paper at the residents helped them return. After defeating them in a professional level game of Twister, well, everyone knows what that is, he helped the Ethats use a matter catalyst, a common household device on Eartha, located, referred to as a blender, to get back home. How that happened, I don't know. I forget reading that material long ago, but that's essentially that little parody story. Now, it's interesting because that's like I said, that's apocryphal material, but that is not canonical with the Star Wars universe. You have to treat it again more like a parody, maybe somewhat comical, somewhat funny, you know, them going to a costume party and seeing people get drunk on the alcohol and etc., etc. Well, anyway. Sort of like a homage. Again, it's more like a homage. Comical, but like a homage. But non-canonical, shall we say. The next one, which I find the most... This is the most fascinating, apocryphal, non-canonical story yet. And obviously you'll know why it's non-canonical in a minute. It was a story called Into the Great Unknown. And it was from a comic book, which was published as part of Star Wars Tales number 19, Star Wars Tales issue 19. And I guess the Star Wars Tales, I'm assuming, I've never read, believe it or not, I've never read Star Wars Tales, but from a little bit I gleaned off of it, I was reading about it. It seems like a lot of what Star Wars Infinities, or what's that comic, I forget, so I do apologize. But it's sort of like what you have in Marvel with the What If. But it's like a non-canonical What If kind of scenario. It doesn't happen, but it's a story that entertains a thought. Well, what if this storyline took place? Or what if this event happened? So I think that's what Star Wars Tales was getting at. But in issue 19, the story Into the Great Unknown featured Earth, although its name was never directly referenced. It acted as a crossover for both Star Wars and the Indiana Jones franchise, which were not only both developed by George Lucas and written by Lucasfilm, but Harrison Ford also played a role in both franchises. Of course, anybody who follows Star Wars and Indiana Jones knows that's an obvious fact. A rhetorical fact, shall we say. Harrison Ford played Han Solo in Star Wars franchise and then Indiana Jones franchise. He played the good doctor himself, because that doctor Indiana Jones. So he played those two roles. Anyway, moving on. The specific setting on the planet took place in the Pacific Northwest, which was subtly referenced by Han Solo's comment that the forest he crashed landed in resembled Endor. The events of the comic, in addition to referencing Star Wars, also included some references to Indiana Jones franchise. Dr. Jones' reference to Atlantis indicated that the comic took place after the events of Indiana Jones and the Fate of Atlantis issue in the comic series. Earth, Dr. Indiana Jones' home world, was orbited by at least one moon, had a relatively large amount of surface water, and had a forest resembling that of Endor. The forest was home to a tribe of humans that made primitive combat technology like spears, bows, and axes. After the Millennium Falcon crash landed in the forest and the members of the tribe killed Han Solo with arrows, they started referring to Chewbacca as Sasquatch. 126 years later, they led Dr. Jones and Shorty to the remains of the ship, which was the Millennium Falcon. So, okay, let's place this in history. What we have here is that somehow Han Solo and Chewbacca and the Millennium Falcon got lost, came to the Milky Way galaxy, crash-landed on Earth in the plains of North America. This happened 126 years prior to Dr. Jones and Shorty. You remember Shorty from the second Indiana Jones film, Temple of Doom, which happened in 1935. So if you subtract 126 years from 1935, you're coming to very early in the 19th century. So I guess when they talked about spears and bows and axes and stuff like that, referring to that Han Solo and Chewbacca encountered the Native American, because this is prior to the colonies or the colonials traveling out west, colonizing the west. So they probably encountered a lot of Native Americans with using their bows and spears as their weapons. And obviously in a skirmish, Han Solo was killed by one of the Native Americans. One of the arrows pierced him, and he died. And of course, Chewbacca lived, and Wookiees have a long lifespan. They can live a couple hundred years, obviously. And so Chewbacca went on living, but he lived an obscure life, just walking the woods of North America in this tale. And the Native Americans and later the colonials from out west saw him, and of course the Native Americans referred to him as Sasquatch, Bigfoot. You know, the white man referred to him as Bigfoot, the Native Americans referred to him as Sasquatch. Which, very interesting tale. Again, like I said, it's a parody, a homage parody, a story told of like a what-if story in the comic series Star Wars Tales of issue 19. The story was Into the Great Unknown, but it was a fascinating story, but it was a story of Han Solo and Chewbacca crash landing on Earth in the North American continent. Very interesting. Essentially, that ends my coverage of the apocryphal material. Now, I'm going to go on, now finally, to getting to the big part. You know, this is the big tamale. This is the big event, which I was getting to, is what I feel is canonical. And some of the stuff is canonical, so I'm going to try to relate it to why I think Earth exists. A strong possibility Earth exists. And this is the race of Asogians. The race of Asogians. This is the third part, the final part. Well, what are the Asogians? Well, you'll know in a second if you don't know. This should be interesting for those of you who might not have made the connection. The Asogian race, or the Asogians, were paddle-footed, large-eyed, sentient, indigenous to the planet Brodo Asogi. Okay, the planet Brodo Asogi. Okay, what is the planet Brodo Asogi? Brodo Asogi was a planet, but it was also known by its nickname, the Green Planet. It was located near the border of the Outer Rim territories and wild space. I think I had brought that planet up in my Star Wars Mythology #1 blog on the galaxy. But I mentioned that I was going to talk more about the Brodo Osogi and the and their native species, the native race, the Osogians. For those of you, let me give a little spoiler for before I go on. What are the Osogians? Think E.T. Think of E.T. E.T. is an Osogian, okay? But anyway, let me move on and we'll get to some of those great little details in a second. Approximately 32 BBY, 32 years before the Battle of Yavin, this takes us to the events, the beginning of Episode 1, The Phantom Menace. The Osogians were represented in the Galactic Republic. They were represented in the Galactic Senate of the Republic by Senator Greblyips, if I'm pronouncing his name like Greblyips. Greblyips. And three of his aides. If you remember, real quick, watching in the convocation hall of the Galactic Senate during in the Phantom Menace, you do see three little characters that look like E.T. And that was Senator in the middle. That was Senator Greblyips. He was a senator, a Osogian senator from Brodo Osogi, representing Brodo Osogi. And the other ones around him were 3/8. Approximately, now keep in mind, he was there. Senator Greblyips was one of the senators who had to reside when Padme brought the vote of no confidence against Supreme Chancellor Finis Valorum. He was one of the senators that was there in the convocation hall who had to vote on impeachment of Valorum, Supreme Chancellor Valorum, which he did, which obviously probably came to regret, which you'll know why in a second. Okay, many years later, going 10 years have passed now, just like in the movies, from Episode 1, The Phantom Menace, to Episode 2, Attack of the Clones. Approximately 22 BBY, 22 years before the Battle of Yavin, Senator Greblyips made galactic headline news when he decided to fund an extragalactic survey, meaning searching for intelligent life in other galaxies. Now, this wasn't the first time. There were several other funded events to leave the galaxy and explore life outside in other galaxies, outside the Star Wars galaxy. We have the Outbound Flight Project, which I'm not going to get into because it has a lot to do with the Chiss and the Thrawn trilogy and Grand Admiral Thrawn and the Jedi. I mean, so I'm not going to get into the details of that, but that the Outbound Flight Project was one of the projects that was funded by the Republic to search for life outside the galaxy. And Senator Greblyips and his Osogian colleagues were searching independent of the Outbound Flight projects. They were searching independently for life outside the galaxy. It was an interest of theirs, and they funded, decided to fund in the Republic, fund an event to search for, do an extragalactic survey and search for intelligent life in other galaxies. But that happened, it's interesting because that happened very late. I mean, the Outbound Flight project happened before 22 BBY. 22 BBY brings us up because later that year, the Clone Wars broke out. Unfortunately, later that year after Senator Greblyips began that extragalactic survey, the Clone Wars broke out. And at the latter part of the Clone Wars, because 2 years following, which would have brought us to 20 BBY or 19 BBY, close to 19 BBY, towards the latter part or the latter end of the Clone Wars, when Supreme Chancellor Palpatine took more emergency powers, Senator Greblyips and many other senators felt that Palpatine was violating the Galactic Constitution, which he was. He was violating the Constitution of the Galactic Republic by taking all those powers, almost like a despot. So the senators made a formal protest against Palpatine. But then, as everybody knows who watched Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith, when the Jedi tried to take Palpatine out of power, Palpatine put Order 66, Jedi Purge, in, and that's when Palpatine declared himself as Emperor of the Galactic, rechristened the Republic as the Galactic Empire, and made himself Emperor under a new charter. I guess disbanding the Galactic Constitution of the Republic. And then, because Grebleyips and the 62 other senators were protesting and calling for a vote to have Palpatine removed, Palpatine declared them as traitors of the Galactic Empire and had them all arrested for treason and placed in prison. Interesting enough. What happened? What was his fate? Grebleyips' fate. Now, moving on, I want to talk, because like I said, the Asogians are clearly E.T. You know, they are the race of E.T. But let me move on. Let me make this statement. Although the appearance of the Asogians in Star Wars Episode 1, The Phantom Menace, was supposed to be an Easter egg, quote, Easter egg, unquote, by George Lucas. You know what an Easter egg is, something that's added into the movie or the DVD or whatever that's a homage to something. It was supposed to be a, quote, Easter egg, unquote, by George Lucas as an homage to Steven Spielberg for E.T., and can be argued that Star Wars and E.T. are two separate canons and have nothing to do with each other. But in spite of that, it can also be argued that there is some potential real canonical connections between the two franchises. So, most people, like I said, most people probably, you know, like the fans that I spoke about, and also some of the EU authors that I spoke about as well, would probably argue that having the Asogians in Episode 1, The Phantom Menace, was sort of like an Easter egg homage for Steven Spielberg, because he had some Star Wars reference material in E.T., which I'm about to mention in a second. It was sort of like his version of having an homage for that, you know, saying thank George Lucas's way of saying thank you to Steven Spielberg, because they had such a close relationship and working together. But they really have nothing to do with each other. It was just sort of like an Easter egg homage, but E.T. and Star Wars have nothing to do with each other. But I'm also arguing, I'm going to make some arguments, that there's just enough strength. Again, like I said, you have to take this with a grain of salt. These are opinions. Both sides have equal amount of weight and evidence for their opinion. But I'm going to offer my opinion, my personal opinion, to the opposite view and give you the evidence reasons why I'm making this educated opinion. So anyway, let me move on. First, okay, this is the argument I'm making. Because the Asogians appeared in Episode 1, The Phantom Menace, these E.T.-like creatures are canonical in the Star Wars mythology and are not apocryphal parody. Just like I said, the other things with the Doros being kidnapped by humans and taken to a costume parade party, or Han and Chewie crash land on Earth, the Millennium Falcon on Earth in the North American, and Han gets killed, and Chewie by the Native Americans. Han gets killed by the Native Americans, and Chewie is mistaken for Sasquatch Bigfoot. Well, those are all apocrypha canonical. You can't say they have any connections with the Star Wars canon. But of course, the six movies, along with the Clone Wars series, but we're not talking about the Clone Wars, the six saga movies, episodes 1 through episode 6, are absolute canonical movies. They're absolute canon for the Star Wars universe and the Star Wars mythology. So these Asogians that do appear in episode 1 are not apocryphal parody material. They are canonical. They are a canonical race. And canonical planet and a canonical race to the Star Wars mythology, the Star Wars universe. So that's the first argument that I'm making. E.T., the Book of the Green Planet, now keep in mind, I think, if I'm not mistaken, that was a book that came out at the time in the 80s when E.T. was out in the theater for the first time. It was like a children's book or a family-oriented book talking about E.T. and E.T.'s homeworld. But E.T., it's called E.T., The Book of the Green Planet, reveals, quote, children of the green planet, unquote, to be the translated name of E.T. species. It also mentions several names which other alien species have given E.T.'s homeworld, such as, in the list of this, such as Brodo-Asogi. Interesting, back then, even back then, this book, this children's book mentions that E.T. comes from a planet known as, their planet of origins was originally the Green Planet. And then it also mentions that other alien species have mentioned the official name of E.T.'s home planet as Brodo-Asogi. Brodo-Asogi is officially, according to Star Wars canon, the official home planet of the Asogian species, the Asogian race. Of course, Brodo-Asogi is also translated as the, quote, the green planet, unquote. While a species with the same name and appearance is itself part of the Star Wars canon, and the homeworld name is given in the EU novel Cloak of Deception. So, in the EU novel Cloak of Deception, Brodo-Asogi is given to the Asogian, is given as name of the planet for the Asogian race. Okay. Now, that's the second evidence part that I give. Now, keep in mind, I'm not saying any of these things are just pieces of evidence, like putting pieces of a puzzle together. And I'm putting pieces of a puzzle together to say, this is my opinion. Take it with a grain of salt, because it's still obscure. But this is just my opinion, and this is how the conclusion, how I came to. These are the pieces of the puzzle that I put together and how I came to this conclusion. But moving on, the third part, piece of the evidence. When E.T. goes trick-or-treating, this should be very familiar for all of those who've seen the movie E.T., when E.T. goes trick-or-treating with the children, he spots a child in a Yoda mask and begins to follow that child, saying, home, home. This could be interpreted as E.T. recognizing a familiar species from his home galaxy. Interesting enough. Interesting theory. Now, some have argued because of that. They've also argued the counter-argument by saying, wait a minute now. There are some problems with that. There are some problems, and this is what they give for those who reject the idea E.T. is connected with Star Wars universe, Star Wars canon. This is what they say. Arguing against this theory, some would say that the scene where Elliot, remember Elliot is the young child, the boy child who befriended E.T., the scene where Elliot shows E.T. his Star Wars action figure collection makes the assumption that Star Wars is a fictional story and E.T. Okay, so some would say, you know, you remember that scene too where Elliot's saying, here, look at the, and he shows him the action figures of Star Wars, like Boba Fett and Lando Calrissian and stuff like that. Well, obviously, Star Wars is a fictional story in the E.T. world, and, you know, E.T. stories, so Star Wars is fictional. So if it's fictional, there's no way they're arguing that it could be real. That's a good argument. That's a good argument. But not an absolute argument. I'm going to give a counter-argument. A counter-argument can be that the Force has given Earthlings a supernatural knowledge of the Star Wars galaxy. The Force can... Okay, and what I'm saying is, if you remember Yoda's statement, do the Force, Luke, he says, things you can see, the future, the past... And he's talking about that. Essentially, what Yoda's teaching Luke on Dagobah is that for a Force user, for a Jedi who uses the Force, they can see things that they don't see with their naked eye or are not knowledgeable. They can come into things that for the future. Obviously, Luke saw in the future. Leia, we know, saw in the past. Remember when Luke, in Return of the Jedi, Luke says, do you have any memories of your mother? Because it's when he was introducing to her. That he was her, that they were twins, fraternal twins. And Luke says, do you have any memories of your mother? And Luke says, I don't have any memories, but Leia says, yes, I do. And you know, she was sweet, kind, beautiful, but very sad, and she died when I was very young. Well, she died, we know that she died in infancy, soon right after she was born. So an infant doesn't have memories, living memories, of things back then. So if when Padme died, technically, she shouldn't have living memory of her mother, but she does. How does she? Well, through the Force. The Force, and she doesn't know. I mean, and that's when Luke reveals to her that she is his twin sister, and she too has the ability in the Force, and that's the reason why. She doesn't understand why she has memories of her mother, because she knows she shouldn't, but she does, because the Force gave her that knowledge. Well, I think it's also possible, I can argue, the reason why, well, is because the Force has given the knowledge to human beings of the Star Wars galaxy. They've related, they think of it as a fictional universe. Elliot, you know, has action Star Wars action figures, and I'm sure people go see the movie Star Wars, but in reality, which they don't know, unbeknownst to them, but probably known to E.T., obviously, is that the Star Wars galaxy is a real galaxy. It's beyond the Force is given. The thing is, it's not just a fictional universe. It is reality for them in their universe. Their fictional universe, it is actually real. The Star Wars galaxy is not just fiction, but it is a reality. But it's unbeknownst to Elliot and the rest of humanity. But known to E.T., obviously. And that's why he recognizes things like the child dresses up like Yoda, thinking, oh, home, home. Because he's thinking he's seeing a species that's native to his own galaxy. I also like to think, too, now keep in mind, remember like I said, if the Earth does exist, the humans and all the animals on Earth would also have midichlorians and also would be sensitive to the Force. Now obviously the teachings of the Jedi and the Sith wouldn't be there on Earth, because that's something that's exclusive to the Star Wars galaxy, to the natives or the people in the Star Wars galaxy. But they still would have a sense of the Force. They would be Force sensitive, and they would have knowledge of the Force, not direct knowledge, but an ability to relate to the Force. And I like to think the Force can explain the reason why so many humans on Earth have psychic abilities. Think of the movies like The Gift with Kate Blanchett had real psychic abilities to have precog and certain knowledge that she wouldn't have normally. It was with supernatural knowledge. And if you ever see the TV show Medium, which I loved, with Patricia Arquette, you know, she played Alison Dubois on the TV show Medium, where she had psychic connection with the supernatural. I like to think, and those are based, you know, Medium is based, you know, Alison Dubois is a real person. She's playing a character who is actually a real person in real life. I like to think that all these people with psychic abilities, the Force can explain that. The Force gives humans these psychic abilities. Now, the psychics don't know where their powers come from. They know they have the power, but they don't know where the powers come from. I like to think it's the Force. They're Force sensitive. They have a high, you know, Alison Dubois would have a high, example, Alison Dubois would have a high midichlorian count. So she would be attuned to the Force. She wouldn't know it's the Force, but she would be attuned. The Force would give her the ability to have these psychics. Like, I like to think that would be a good explanation. Okay, now I would like to conclude this by saying my own personal theory. Now keep in mind, I'm going to read this paragraph which I wrote up. But take it with a grain of salt. I'm not saying it's absolute. I'm making my conclusion based on all the pieces I'm putting together, and I'm just giving my own personal opinion based on my own personal educated opinion based on all the pieces that I put together. I could be wrong. Other theories that they have, those who are opposing, are just as valid. So I'm not putting them down. I'm just saying that this is the preferred, because keep in mind, like what I said at the beginning, this is going to be a question that's going to be probably forever in obscurity. And even if the Disney Lucasfilm team come out with an official statement, I'm not going to take them serious, because to me, only what Lucas has said matters. But anyway, with no further ado, let me get to my concluding statement about my opinion on the issue of does Earth exist in the Star Wars universe. My personal theory, to be taken, quote, to be taken with a grain of salt, unquote, is that Earth does exist in the Star Wars universe. Sometime during the time of the Galactic Empire, somehow, Senator Grebleeps was able to escape his imprisonment by Emperor Palpatine. And trying to escape the tyranny of the Galactic Empire, Grebleeps led what was remaining of his people out of the galaxy, meaning the Star Wars galaxy, as they fled to the Milky Way galaxy, and then they settled on a habitable, uninhabited planet so they can live their lives in freedom and in peace. While the Asogians were exploring the Milky Way galaxy, I guess, keep in mind, this would be after they settled on the planet and got established, they start exploring the Milky Way galaxy. They discovered the planet Earth, and that it was inhabited by humans very similar, if not the same, to the ones in their home galaxy. When they landed on Earth to explore it, the Asogians attracted the attention of a faction of Earth's government. You know, the CIA or the Alien Task Force and the CIA, probably. That's the faction that they got. They got the attention of which they were trying to catch up with these Asogians and discover what they're all about. And Asogians got spooked, and they made a hurriedly retreat from Earth. If you've seen the movie E.T., that's exactly what happened. They made a hurriedly retreat from Earth, and accidentally leaving one of their own behind, which was E.T. in the movie E.T. This gave rise for a human male child named Elliot. We know Elliot as the human boy who discovered the Asogian, took the Asogian into his house to protect him, and he named him E.T. And then the rest of, his little sister, Gertrude, and his older brother discovered E.T., and then they had adventures with Elliot and his family. And you've seen the movie. I don't need to run the whole movie before you, the plot of the whole movie. But at the end, E.T. was able to phone home. And Elliot was able to help E.T. reach his home race of Asogians, his home people. And they returned to Earth to pick him up. And then E.T. left with his people back to the planet which they settled on in the Milky Way galaxy. So essentially that is my personal theory when it comes to answering the question, does Earth exist in the Star Wars galaxy? Like I said, it does exist, and E.T., there is a canonical connection between canonicity and continuity connection between E.T. and the Star Wars in Star Wars. And I just laid it out, which I think that's what happened. My opinion, that's what happened. Again, take it with a grain of salt. It's ambiguous whether that's actually what happened, but it's my belief that that did happen. Only George Lucas can change that belief. I'm not going to allow Hidalgo or Chi or anybody else to change my opinion. But others are welcome. Other fans are certainly welcome to take an opposite opinion because their opinions are just as valid. Because it's so ambiguous, their opinions are just as valid as mine. So if you need any clarity, so I would like to say in ending this blog, if you need any clarification, please comment. Or if you want to share your opinion on the whole issue or your point of view on the whole issue, then please feel free to comment. I would love to see your opinion or your questions on this issue. It's a very complex issue, I understand, but I tried to give my 2 cents on the entire issue. So hopefully this has been a blog that has been very edifying and learning about things that we know are fact, but also exploring theories on things that are ambiguous and theoretical. But in the end of that, I think it's time to end this video. I wanted to thank everyone for watching my video. I do appreciate it. I do appreciate it very much, especially since this is another long one. If you like my video, please subscribe to my channel so you get to all the latest updates. I do cherish all my subscribers, but hopefully it will benefit you, as it will help you to get all the latest updates when I do them, because I do one of these video blogs, these long detailed mythology blogs, once a month, and that's what I'm going to try to continue to doing. For my next video, it'll be Doctor Who Mythology number 2 on the topic of Gallifrey and the Time Lords. I think it's about time that I covered that topic on Gallifrey and the Time Lords, because I'm setting up foundational material for each of these, for Star Wars and Doctor Who. But in doing that, I think it's time. I spent enough time on this video. Again, I encourage you to subscribe to my channel and also to make comments, send me a comment. If you have a question for clarification, or if you want to share your theory on this topic, that's fine. Your theory is just as valid as mine. But in ending that, I think it's time to end this video, and I want to bid everyone a good day, and may the Force be with you.